I know how it is. With all intentions to fuck, got interrupted again. I was doing good, had to take a whole nother L. You'd rather lose a sack instead of getting indicted for a sale. I would never fail against negativity. I prevail. We living a good life. Leap, we ain't worried about 12. When I parallel and further ahead, I excel. Everybody, y'all think real. I look at them like 12. Rejecting your comparisons. Sing your man, I bury him. Shaping my ship with my soul. Rappers in the last detail. I made it in the hood. I can do anything except fail. Mama, thank you for them times that you paid my bail. Even knew you knew I wasn't gonna change. Get out and raise hell. Now all these young cats coming up think they gangsta as hell. I know on that the life they living gon' have them dead or in jail.
Yeah,
you
dreamed out your life right here, chasing a bag in these streets. Yeah, I seen it happen before, so I suggest that you take it from me.
You ain't Superman, you can't start quitless. The fans and snitches, they ain't gon' let you keep pushing.
So don't get you got your life out here, chasing a bag in these streets.
Money, yeah, you know we got to have it. Everybody got needs and everybody got to have it. A million hustles, king, go ahead and choose one. Maybe two, or three. You need that income, but don't be out here hustling for pennies and selling them dimes. Don't be a fool out here committing ridiculous crimes. You got kids, you got family, man, they life on the line. Whatever problem, come up, handle it like Tyson the Prime. You a king, black man, step up and prove that you won. She a queen, black man, why don't we treat her like one? She ain't a dog, black man, why do we beat her like one? I'ma stand for our unity, go hard till I'm done. You can't be asleep when it comes, gotta look out for the jail. Get out the butt with the craft, make a positive impact. That's rap don't matter, you know, man. I grew up with you hands. Stop listening to these rap songs and use your brain, young man.
Hey, hey, come on, let's make a toast. Come on, let's make a toast. I give a toast on the feast day. Eat the good, drink good, let it replay. We bring it back to the holy day. Babylon, what we celebrate the Lord's day. I give a toast on the feast day. Eat the good, drink good, let it replay. Bring it back to the holy day. Babylon, what we celebrate the Lord's day. I give a toast on the feast day. To all my loved ones no longer here, they passed away. I give a toast on the feast day. To all my saints that repented and to change their ways. I give a toast on the feast day. Cause we don't celebrate holidays on heathen ways. I give a toast on the feast day. I love that Passover lamb, I'ma clean the plate. Make sure the bread ain't got no leaven in it. Symbolizing, reminiscing of how we stopped sinning. So many different occasions, yeah, how we gave deliverance. Yeah, we remember the time, that's how we Thanksgiving. We hold a feast of dedication, I know we get Christmas. Need to research what you celebrate, it's paganistic. I'm in the spirit on the holy days, I feel terrific. Only a glass or two of wine, so I don't feel eccentric. I give a toast on the feast day. Drink good, let it replay. We bring it back to the holy days. Babylon, what we celebrate the Lord's day. I give a toast on the feast day. Eat that and drink good, let it replay. We bring it back to the holy days. Babylon, what we celebrate the Lord's day.
Hey, you know ain't no false and bound. And I go hard for mine. So what you think when the feast is on the couch? And these three things so beautiful, you know I'm with the family. Your ways from before became a distant memory. Family reunion every week, yeah, this is for the sale. How you love her, you don't keep the four commandments. Put down the things you did before, yeah, that's repentance. We put the fridges on our garments, they can't stand. I'm like, who fly to me? Spirit, get high in. Like the Messiah trying to be. But I'll be on power, me to sit by the people. 7 months, 10 days, I feel free. My favorite feast, tabernacle, supposed to tend to the wilderness for a week. Make sure the ox got a bottle on ice. I treat my brothers like myself. With no worries for tomorrow. Today we live without a kill. I'm praise the Most High, let's have a toast. Put your drinks in the hell. Cause it's a righteous
event. I give a toast on the feast day. Eat the good, drink good, let it replay. We bring it back to the to the holy day. Babylon, what we celebrate the Lord's day. I give a toast on the feast day. Eat that good, drink good, let it replay. Bring it back to the holy day. Babylon, what we celebrate the Lord's day.
Shalom, shalom, family. Shalom, up.
Shalom.
Brother Devon, shalom, up. I'm going to put the link in the chat for you if you want to come up and, you know, add precepts as we go throughout the lesson. Hold on a second. And I just want to start out by giving all praise, honor, and glory to the Most High God, whose name is Yahweh, in the name of his only begotten Son, whose name is Yahweh Shai. And brother Aaron, if you could put that in the chat. Oh, hold on, I got it. That's all right. I already got a copy too.
Gotcha.
But no, I ain't gonna let me do it on the stream, y'all. Yeah, if you could go ahead and post that link for Brother Devon. But shalom, family. Gotcha. If y'all haven't already, go ahead, like and share the video. And like the brother Aaron said, make sure to tag your friends and family by using the highlight feature. You add and then you start typing highlight and it's going to pop up. You just click it and it's going to help people get access to that comment and also to the video. It's very a useful, handy tool. But so the lesson, the title for the lesson is How Important Is Your Faith? And if you see the artwork for this lesson, I have like the man leaping over the gaping hole to get over to the other side of the cliff. And, you know, that symbolism, a leap of faith, taking a leap of faith. You know, we can say all day, every day that we have faith, but our actions determine whether we have faith or not. So we can go ahead and get ready to get into this thing. Brother Aaron, unless you want anything you want to say or bring out, you can go ahead.
Yeah, I don't have too much. Just make sure to like and tag all your friends.
And everybody, if you can hear us clearly, put a one in the chat, just as long as you don't hear any echoes or, you know, any lagging or anything, put a one in the chat to let us know before we continue. And just a reminder, you know, if y'all have any questions or any topics or anything, you know, that you may need a little more understanding on, you can also type it in the chat or whatever. And any scriptures, precepts you have, also type them in the chat. Aaron, you're a little echoey. That's crazy. I wonder why it's doing that. He just said that before we started listening, it was doing that. Hopefully it ain't too bad. Brother, say something again. Let's see. See what they say about how bad the echo is.
Mic check. Yeah, it's still doing the same.
That's crazy.
What I can do? My phone.
Shalom. All right, you joining with your phone, brother?
Come on.
All right, that sounds like that may be a little better. I couldn't really hear the echo, but I can tell a little difference. It sounds a little more, with a little more clarity.
Yeah, it's still an echo.
Yeah, that was before you just started talking. All right. Put a one in the chat if he's clear, y'all.
All right,
Brother Devon, can you say something?
I hear that.
Dang, still echoing. That's weird. Let me see.
Hey, brother, hey, brother, you got Mike on mute. On mute. Hey, brother Devon, can you say something?
Yeah, I can hear you.
I think I don't hear an echo from you, and I don't think I'm echoing.
You're not echoing no more. It's good.
He said give it a second, but if y'all haven't already, just make sure to like and share the video. Use the at highlight feature to tag all your friends and family that are on your friends list. You get one of those per day, so make sure to utilize it. All right, can y'all hear me? Think that's better.
Mic check. Still an echo.
Man, that's weird.
The reason why is because it's two of you.
Oh no, I thought. Let me see.
Yeah, there's two of you up on the stage.
Two of yours on the stage.
Yeah, but my other one is muted and it's turned down.
I don't know why I'm having this problem today.
I think one is going from the other.
Nah, that was happening before.
But yeah, give me a second, y'all. We're gonna get it right. Have faith.
You're a trip.
Man, just y'all put a prayer up that the brother Hurt gets an iPhone, puts down that filthy.
Yeah, that's what it is right there. I wasn't gonna say that.
God.
And y'all so weak. I got one in the house. I just don't want it.
Stiff neck Jake, man. I can never hear it. Hey, brother, you here?
And so while we waiting, I'm gonna just play a little song real quick. Oh, you got a book?
All right, can I be heard now?
Yeah, kind of.
That's clear without an echo.
You're not echoing.
Okay.
Echoing whenever somebody else sit down.
Yeah, still. That's so weird.
You want me to play a song while you do that?
Time, you can do that, bro.
I can't. That's all right. Family, we're going to play a song real quick, whatever. You know why they get that fixed up.
Boy. I was just joking with you.
I'm out of mute because it's echoing still.
And pain. Looking for a light. Trying to find the truth. But we give them doubt saying we do something we don't.
Hurting people saying we do things that we won't. Whooping she's clothing with a cross on his chest. Taking people money, promising to be blessed. But power to the chosen people, who at one point wasn't viewed as an equal. His own chosen people, royal priest. Yeah. And that you've been called out of the dark into the morning sun. Do you know who you are? Royalty, yeah. Once we weren't the people, now we are the people. You know who you are. Royalty. Would you let them call you those things if you knew you were a queen? And my brother, would you be out there risking your life for green paper if you knew you had it all already, if you knew you were a king? Well, the best I can offer is to tell you the truth. Mercy changed everything for me and you. But they don't really tell us what we do need to know. 1 Peter 2 and 6, a blessing for sure. So power to the chosen people, who at one point wasn't viewed as an equal. His own chosen people, a royal priesthood. Hey. Said that you were called out of the dark, into the morning sun. Do you know who you are? Royalty. Once we weren't the people, mercy made us the people. Now we are the people.
Royalty. There we go. Am I good, y'all? Can I be heard?
Mic check. Nah, you all good, man.
God, all praises. All praises.
All praises.
Faith. Faith. Faith gonna prompt you to do something. Take some actions because you believe. All praises, man. But yeah, the water for y'all bearing with us, man. So we're gonna go ahead and get into this thing because we done waste a good bit of time, but you know, lesson learned. Ain't nothing happens for no reason. So, what is faith? So, I got a definition from the Cruden's Complete Concordance on page 199, and I'm gonna read it for y'all. It says, faith, a dependence on the veracity of another, And veracity just means the truth of another. It says firm belief or trust in a person, thing, doctrine, or statement. And one is said to keep faith when he performs a promise made to another. That sounds familiar, don't it, y'all? You think about those covenants, the covenant that the Most High God made with us, and how if we follow and we obey, we get rewards from obeying the covenant. So having that faith, because that's what it is, we have faith in those words that the Most High speaks to us, that he's gonna do right by what he said he's gonna do. He's either gonna curse us or he's gonna bless us according to our obedience. So we're gonna get to the first scripture, which is in James chapter 2, and we'll start with verses 19 and 20.
Come. This is the book of James, chapter 2, starting in verse 19. Thou believest that there is one God. Thou doest well. The devils also believe and tremble. But wilt thou know, O vain man, that faith without works is dead? And you said down to 21 or stop at 20?
Oh, 21. 19 and 20 first. You good. That's good. That's good enough. So it says, thou believest that there is one God, thou doest well. The devils also believe and tremble. But wilt thou know, O vain man, that faith without works is dead? So we see that just showing faith in something, in a belief, is more than just saying, I believe. We got to do something more than just say, I believe. That's not showing faith. I mean, you can show faith in a belief by just saying, yeah, I believe in it. But it takes more actions from us. So it says, but wilt thou know, O vain man, that faith without works is dead? So for me to say I believe in something but not show my actions that require, you know, the requirements of the necessity of showing those things to say that I have faith in that thing, I'm just fooling myself. Brother, if you could, go ahead and grab 21 and 22.
James 2, verse 21. Was not Abraham, our father, justified by works when he had offered Isaac, his son, upon the altar? Seest thou how faith wrought with his works, and by works was faith made perfect?
Time. Grab ra in the Greek.
Come. This is Strong's G4903 soon erg ale, which in the biblical usage is to work together, help in work, be partner in labor, to put forth power together with and thereby to assist. And the definition is to be a fellow worker, i.e. cooperate, help, work with, worker together.
Con the water and brother Miles West, if you want to, we can schedule a time to talk about that topic that you're talking about in the comments. I'll be just fine with it. You can hit my inbox, my brother. But the brother just brought the definition out, rock. Something being rocked with works, that means that they go hand in hand. You can't have one without the other. They work together to establish that you have faith. So saying that you have faith but not doing the necessary things that's going to make you, you know, that are going to complement your belief means you have no faith at all. So it says, was not Abraham our father justified by works when he had offered Isaac his son upon the altar? Seest thou how faith wrought with his works, and by works was faith made perfect? We know that Abraham took his son because the Most High told him to take his son up on that mountain, and he got ready to slay him. He had the blade like he was going to slay him, but he knew that God wasn't going to allow him to kill his own son. And through faith, he just carried out the commandment that God gave him without you know, having anything, no qualms about it, asking any questions. He just obeyed. We have to be the same way as Abraham. Regardless of how you feel about a commandment that the Most High God gives you, you just obey. Regardless, don't make excuses and don't try to find an easy way out of it, because there is no easy way out of it. We just got to be obedient, and that's how we show that we have faith. Brother, if you could grab Hebrews 11, verses 6 and 7.
It's lucky I got something up on Abraham real quick.
Con, go ahead, brother.
Yeah, Genesis 26, 5. Just to show that Abraham's faith had works incorporated with it. That really showed that he had faith.
Con, this is the book of Genesis, chapter 26 and verse 5. Because that Abraham obeyed my voice and kept my charge, my commandments, my statutes, and my laws.
Definitely. And that's just because his obedience, that's what, you know, issued the promise as well. It wasn't just him just saying he believed. But you got it, brother.
Con, the water, brother. Grab Hebrews 11, 6 and 7.
Con, this is the book of Hebrews chapter 11, starting at verse 6. But without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. By faith, Noah, being warned of God of things not seen as yet, moved with fear, prepared an ark to the saving of his house, by the which he condemned the world, and became heir of the righteousness which is by faith.
Come. So, you know, the topic is, how important is your faith? We see that your faith is very important. It says, but without faith, it's impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. Diligently. That means you're hard at it. You're constantly doing it. And so when we really look at verse 6, it says, without faith, it's impossible to please him. So without being obedient to God, you can't please God. It says he's a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. And it says you must believe that he is. And if you believe that God is God, who he says he is, that means you know he's going to do what he said he's going to do. If we be disobedient, there are curses that's going to come upon us. If we're obedient, we will be able to receive life. And it says, by faith, Noah, being warned of God of things not seen as yet, moved with fear, prepared an ark to the saving of his house, by the which he condemned the world and became heir of the righteousness which is by faith. At this point in time, we should be, as believers, especially as we see these prophecies unfolding, we should be preparing an ark for our household. Because that's faith. And that fear is going to drive you to do that, because you know that the Most High God stands on what he says. So if he presents a prophecy throughout scripture, you know that that prophecy is going to come to pass regardless. So, brother, grab a precept for this in Proverbs 9, 10 and 11. And the water, brother, for responding to that brother in the comments, because we don't mind you being here. You're welcome. We definitely want you here, brother. But, you know, we can have that dialogue about what you're talking about in the comments. We can have it live. And I stand on what I teach and what I know in the Bible. So, may God be true.
This is the book of Proverbs, chapter 9, starting at verse 10. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and the knowledge of the holy is understanding. For by me thy days shall be multiplied, and the years of thy life shall be increased.
So the fear, just like we read that Noah moved in, he had the fear of the Lord. It says the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and the knowledge of the holy is understanding. To fear God is wise, because we know that he's the one that created us. He's the one that controls the outcome of any situation we end up in. And our life is in his hand. So to fear God is wisdom. And the knowledge of the holy is understanding. It says, for by me thy days shall be multiplied, and the years of thy life shall be increased. And in the same breath, we know that by him, our life can be decreased and we can die. We can die eternal death and never see life again. So we got to move in fear of the Most High God, and also out of love, not just out of fear. Brothers, if y'all got anything, y'all could bring it up before I go forward.
Yeah, I just got one precept. It's Psalms chapter 101, verse 6 through 8.
Come. This is Psalm 101, starting at verse 6. Mine eyes shall be upon the faithful of the land, that they may dwell with me. He that walketh in a perfect way, he shall serve me. He that worketh deceit shall not dwell within my house. He that telleth lies shall not tarry in my sight. I will early destroy all the wicked of the land, that I may cut off all wicked doers from the city of Yahweh.
Yeah, kind of, because simply, you know, unfaithfulness, it would be wickedness. If you're faithful, then if you really have faith, you're going to be obeying God. That's just really that simple. It's not going to be any compromise, and it's not going to be any fine line in between. It's not going to be no standing on the fringe. If you truly, you know, fear the Most High and you truly have faith, you're going to be obedient to him. But I'll let you keep on going, brother. I don't got nothing to add past that right now.
Oh, okay, I got a precept to go along with that also.
Go ahead, bro.
This is Sirach 15. I'm gonna pull it up. Just to move in the theme. Con, this is the book of Sirach or Ecclesiasticus, chapter 15 and verse 15. It says, if thou wilt to keep the commandments and to perform acceptable faithfulness. And I know the brother, he's probably going to touch on it throughout the lesson, and he's going to emphasize it. But when you go into the word for faith, it coincides with the word faithfulness, because you look at it, you'll see the definition. Steadfastness, loyalty, trust, as the brother mentioned a little bit earlier. And so
you have the commandments and to perform. So like
nah, you good. But faith and faithfulness are synonymous. And as you read in the scriptures, faith is something that you actually perform. Like even when you read in the book of Habakkuk, the second chapter, it said that the righteous are gonna live by their faith, right? In some translations it says faithfulness. And so this is
2:4.
You know, kind of Habakkuk 2:4, right? So if you're living by your faithfulness, there's something being shown. And even the Apostle James, he speaks about this, and he shows that, you know, faith coupled with works, that's how you produce, you know, a perfect or a perfected faith, right? But I'll pass it back to you, brother.
Con, that was beautiful timing. I'm going to go into John 3:16, one of the most known scriptures, probably the most known scripture ever. And it's a reason, and y'all will see as we go through this, because we're not just going to touch on that one verse in that chapter.
God, it's the book of John, chapter 3, verse 16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life.
Con, you can read 17 also.
Con, verse 17. For Yahweh sent not his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved.
Con. So it says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And this scripture gets butchered so bad, so much, because when people see believeth in him, they just say, yeah, you just gotta believe. But when you believe, action actually accompanies your belief. You can't just say I believe and don't do anything, because if I tell you I believe something but my actions show that I don't, I'm showing something contrary to a belief that I really don't believe, that I believe something's fake, you're going to call me a liar. So it says, verse 17, for God sent not his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. So Yahweh Shai wasn't sent to just condemn people. He was sent to be an example. Like, hey, you see how I'm doing it? This how you do it. You know, the perfect example to make us the perfect people, as perfect as we can be. Brother, you can continue read through verse 21.
Come. Verse 18. He that believeth on him is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already, because he hath not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. And this is the condemnation, that light is come into the world, and men love darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil. For everyone that doeth evil hateth the light, neither cometh to the light, lest his deeds should be reproved. But he that doeth truth cometh to the light, that his deeds may be made manifest, that they are wrought in God.
So verse 18 says, he that believeth on him is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already. And we know, if we don't do what the Most High God said, do we not obedient to these commandments that we find throughout the scripture, what happens? We get cursed. That means we're condemned or we're damned. But if we obey, we're not condemned. And so this shows and highlights that verse 16 is not just talking about saying, I believe. It's accompanied with your works, your obedience. It says, for everyone that doeth evil hateth the light, neither cometh to the light, lest his deeds should be reproved. Why is it talking about deeds? Why is it talking about evil? Why is it talking about light? If we just got to believe, it don't matter about your deeds, right? We just got to believe and then we'll be saved. But nah, this shows that that's not what John 3:16 means. It says, but he that doeth truth cometh to the light, that his deeds may be made manifest, that they are wrought in God. And we're back to that word wrought again. So your deeds have to go hand in hand with your faith, so that God is able to approve you and say that you are a faithful servant. Brother, jump down to verse 36.
Come. Verse 36. It says, he that believeth on the Son hath everlasting life, and he that believeth not the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abideth on him.
Come. Let's precept that with Deuteronomy 4:1.
Come.
Yeah, I got one to bring out after that. You know, about the wrath of God being upon him.
Come. And read verse 2 also, brother.
Come. It's the book of Deuteronomy chapter 4, starting at verse 1. Now therefore hearken, O Israel, unto the statutes and unto the judgments which I teach you, for to do them, that ye may live and go in and possess the land which Yahweh God of your fathers giveth you. Ye shall not add unto the word which I command you, neither shall ye diminish aught from it, that ye may keep the commandments of Yahweh your God, which I command you.
So in John 3:36, it says, he that believe on the Son have everlasting life, and he that believeth not the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abideth on him. And then we jump to Deuteronomy 4:1-2. It says, now therefore hearken, O Israel, into the statutes and to the judgments which I teach you, for to do them, that ye may live and go in and possess the land which the Lord God of your fathers giveth you. Ye shall not add unto the word which I command you, neither shall you diminish aught from it, that ye may keep the commandments of the Lord your God, which I command you. So we see that obedience is the way we get life. Because in John 3:16, it talks about those that believe on him inheriting eternal life. And then when you go to verse 36, it talks about life being given for obedience again. And then we go to Deuteronomy 4, and this is where this logic comes from. It comes from the law. When God told us to be obedient to him, he told us, hey, you receive life when you obey me. And if you don't obey me, you don't receive life. Brother Devon, go ahead and pull your precept.
The water. Colossians chapter 3 and verse 6.
Okay. This is the book of Colossians chapter 3 and verse 6. For which things sake the wrath of God cometh on the children of disobedience.
It comes on who?
The children of disobedience.
Hmm. Simply said right there. Hey, you got it, brother?
Time. The water. Brother, we can go back to Deuteronomy 4 and read verses 6 and 7.
God, this is Deuteronomy 4 and 6. Keep therefore and do them, for this is your wisdom and your understanding in the sight of the nations, which shall hear all these statutes and say, surely this great nation is a wise and understanding people. For what nation is there so great who hath God so nigh unto them as Yahweh our God is in all things that we call upon him for?
So why, you know, people say that the law is done away with. Why would God do away with our wisdom and our understanding? Makes no sense, right? It says, for what nation is there so great who have God so nigh unto them as the Lord our God is in all things that we call upon him for? And I'm going to go back to verse 6. It says, keep therefore and do them, for this is your wisdom and your understanding in the sight of the nations. So when people see us keeping these laws, statutes, and commandments, they understand and recognize that we have wisdom from above, from the Most High God. Because the things that he tells us to do is not just, hey, you just do them because I said so. I mean, it is do it because he said so, but there's reasoning behind it. And it may not be that he's, you know, revealing those things to us. It's just wisdom that we listen to him and fear him, because what he says is a reason he says it. So it's like, okay, Father, I hear you. I'm going to do what you said do, because I know there's a great reason for it. Brother, if you could grab Matthew 4 and 4.
God. It's the book of Matthew, chapter
4. I got something to say real quick, if you don't mind, brother. It's like my son, he a child, you know, and, you know, sometimes when we outside playing, he'll leave his toy in the middle of the driveway. And I'll tell him, I'll say, hey, son, you got to get your toy out the driveway. You got to put it over here where your toy is supposed to go. Why? Right now, he probably thinks, okay, man, he's just making me move my toys. He's just doing this for no reason. But I'm saying this because if you don't do it, I'm going to crush that thing. You know what I'm saying? I'm going to drive my car in this driveway, and you ain't about to have that toy no more. It's a purpose behind me telling him that. It's not me just telling him that because I'm trying to just dictate him and just, you know, I'm trying to make him like a robot. I'm telling him this comes with a consequence. If you don't move with this toy, I'm going to eventually pull in this driveway and run that thing over.
Right.
What you got?
Right. But and you ain't got to tell him that. Just get your car out the driveway.
Yeah, listen. Just get it out the driveway. Just listen. I know what's going to happen.
Right. Con, you can go ahead, brother.
Con, this is the book of Matthew, chapter 4, verse 4. It says, but he answered and said, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God.
We're supposed to live by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. But you got people tell you, don't worry about that stuff God said. That's the old stuff. Don't worry about the old stuff no more. But we're supposed to live by every word that proceeded out of his mouth. And, you know, when you think of us living by every word that proceeded out of God's mouth, that's faith. You can not have no food in your refrigerator. But if you live by every word that the Most High God put in this scripture, guess what? You're going to end up with some food. Because your faith going to make sure you end up with some food. You're being obedient to the Most High God. And guess what he's going to do? Provide for you. That's what he's going to do. But, brother, grab Romans 1 and 17.
Gone. This is the book of Romans, chapter 1 and verse 17. But therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith.
Come on. The just gonna live by faith. It says that the God revealed from faith to faith. For therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith. The righteousness of God is revealed to you because you're obedient to him. You're going to continue to see and reap the benefits of being obedient to the Most High God, because you become his child when you listen to him. You know, you're not the prodigal son anymore. You haven't went out and about and just did what you wanted to do. You listened to your father, and your father was able to establish you and was able to exalt you because of your obedience. Brother, continue reading in this chapter, verses 18 through 22.
Verse 18. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth in unrighteousness, because that which may be known of God is manifest in them, for God hath showed it unto them. For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. Because that when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were thankful, but became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish heart was darkened, professing themselves to be wise. Oh, Salaki.
Yeah, just through Salaki, it was 22, professing themselves to be wise, they became fools. Salaki. But when you read this, this actually helps you realize that folks don't love God, or folks ain't scared of God. They don't think God gonna do nothing. Why? We see it by their disobedience. They don't care to keep the law, statutes, and commandments. They don't fear God. It says, for the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth in unrighteousness. So you got people that profess to love the Most High God, but they holding the truth in unrighteousness. They're not really doing the things that it takes to please this God that they say they love. It says, because that which may be known of God is manifest in them, for God hath shewed it unto them, or showed it unto them. So, you know, it ain't no secret that the commandments are very vital. They protect us. Like, if you do the research on the commandments, like different things, you'll find that scientists have already researched certain stuff about the things that God told us to do. And you find out that, man, it'll really benefit you. People ain't crazy. They know that the stuff that the Lord instructed us in the first five books of the Bible are very vital, and they can help us in life. They just choose not to do it. They choose to obey the lust of the flesh. It says, for the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. It ain't no excuse. Because that when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were thankful, but became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish heart was darkened. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools. You know, that one verse, professing themselves to be wise, they became fools. It reminds me of the lesson I did on how pride prevents correction. Because once you start to say, I know, I know, I know, now you won't listen. Now you're closing your ear up and you don't care what nobody tell you. You're professing yourself to be wise and becoming a fool and looking like a fool. Brother, grab verses 28 through 32.
Come. This is verse 28. It says, and even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a reprobate mind to do those things which are not convenient, being filled with all unrighteousness, fornication, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, debate, deceit, malignity, whisperers, backbiters, haters of God, despiteful, proud, boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents, without understanding, covenant breakers, without natural affection, implacable, unmerciful, who knowing the judgment of God, that they which commit such things are worthy of death, not only do the same, but have pleasure in them that do them.
Time. It's a very dangerous thing for someone to become a reprobate. Because when you read verse 28, it says, and even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge. So this first part is something of a, it's a decision. You can choose to retain God in your knowledge, or you can choose not to. It said, as even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a reprobate mind. So he for a minute, you know, he allows you to decide if you're going to serve him or not. And then once he decides, oh, okay, you don't want to serve me, guess what? I'm going to make sure you don't serve me. So it's like almost like a curse is placed on your mind to make you believe that these things that you're doing are right, but they're wrong. That's a reprobate. And there's nothing no one can do to get you out of that mind state. That's a dangerous thing, because that's something that the Most High God does to people, and they have no control over it. So it says, and being filled with all unrighteousness, fornication, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, debate, deceit, malignity, whisperers, backbiters, haters of God, despiteful, proud, boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents, without understanding, covenant breakers, without natural affection, implacable, unmerciful, who knowing the judgment of God, that they which commit such things are worthy of death, not only do the same, but have pleasure in them that do them. That's just a dangerous thing, because that's the end of the road for a person that thinks in that manner. Brother, if you could grab Hebrews 10, verses 22 and 23.
Come on. This is the book of Hebrews, chapter 10, starting at verse 22. Let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from evil, slacked from an evil conscience, and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering, for he is faithful that promised.
So it says, let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering. To do that, we have to actually work toward that. We have to not give up. We have to really just be determined to show and prove that we have faith. That shows that we're going to meditate on these commandments that the Most High has commanded us to do. And we're going to show and prove, hey, I fear the Most High God. I know he'll do something to me if I continue in wickedness. I'm going to be obedient. I want to inherit eternal life. Brother, grab James 1, verses 5 through 8.
God. This is the book of James, chapter 1, starting at verse 5. If any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God, that giveth to all men liberally, and upbraideth not, and it shall be given him. But let him ask in faith, nothing wavering. For he that wavereth is like a wave of the sea, driven with the wind and tossed. For let not that man think that he shall receive anything of the Lord. A double-minded man is unstable in all his ways.
So when you look at verse 5, it says, if any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God, that giveth to all men liberally, and upbraideth not, and it shall be given him. Some details that go along with you asking for this wisdom. It said, but let him ask in faith, nothing wavering, for he that wavereth is like a wave of the sea, driven with the wind and tossed. When you look at wavering, that means doubt. You have doubt. And also to show and express that you have doubt, that means you're not going to practice what you know to do. You're going to do things that are contrary to the will of God. You're supposed to believe and love God, but you're going to be disobedient to the commandments. That shows a lack of faith. And so now the Most High God can't work on your behalf because your faith ain't pure. It ain't all the way there. So
this is something we have to do. We have to analyze ourselves and say, am I just outright rejecting the Most High God commandments? Because if I am, my faith is wavering. And now I'm blocking my own self from receiving blessings that he can give to me. You know? So it says verse 6 through 8, it says, but let him ask in faith, nothing wavering, for he that wavereth is like a wave of the sea, driven with the wind and tossed. For let not that man think that he shall receive anything of the Lord. A double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. We got to be able to stand on what we believe, not change it for nobody because you feel uncomfortable when you go around certain people that's still in the world. I stand on it. I care nothing about it. You know, that's how we got to be when it comes to the Most High God. You know what I'm saying? Brothers, if y'all got anything y'all can add, pull something out now. I got a couple more scriptures. Got like two more scriptures.
I got one, and I put it in the chat already, so I just put it on the screen. It's Ecclesiasticus or Sirach 32 and 24. It says, he that believeth in the Lord taketh heed to the commandment, and he that trusteth in him shall fare never the worse. And it kind of goes back to what you were saying a little bit earlier, because when you go into the verbiage of, you know, taking heed, it means to pay attention to. Now you have a bunch of people that espouse to be quote unquote Christians or believers, but they'll tell you, don't even read the law of God. Like they'll say, don't put yourself under a yoke of bondage. Don't even get into the law because it works wrath. But if you truly believe in the Most High, you're going to pay attention to what God commanded and what God desires from you. And you're going to, what's the word? You're going to adhere to it. Right. And when you trust in the Most High in that particular way, you know, you're always going to end out well, you know, and not necessarily that it's going to be a walk in the park every single day, but you doing the will of the Most High is never an evil thing, but it's only a good thing. Right. But I pass to you, all y'all brothers.
Brother, you got anything to learn?
Yeah, kind of. Could you go to Acts chapter 14 and read verse 21 and 22?
God. Is the book of Acts chapter 14, verse 21. And when they had preached the gospel to that city and had taught many, they returned again to Lystra and to Iconium and to Antioch, confirming the souls of the disciples and exhorting them to continue in the faith, and that we must through much tribulation enter into the kingdom of God.
Because it's not like as it's easy to do these things. It's going to take tribulation. We're going to go through stuff, but we have to exhort you that you continue in the faith, that you continue in this walk. You don't, like the brother Herb was saying, you don't allow the things that people around you may say, you know, about the things that you do or the faith that you have to deter you from it. And so you got it, brother. I got a couple other precepts, but I'm going to see what else you got to bring out first.
Con. Give me John 9 and 31.
Con. This is the book of St. John, chapter 9 and verse 31. Now we know that God heareth not sinners, but if any man be a worshiper of God and doeth his will, him he heareth.
And you know, a lot of people don't understand is you hear people say, God do listen to sinners. God love the sinner. You know, which is the craziest thing ever.
But love the sinner, hate the sin.
I heard that so much growing up, man. I believed it too as a child. But as you grow up and then you read the Bible and you get more verses than this that say this pretty much the same thing. It says, now we know that God heareth not sinners. Hold up, he don't hear the sinner? But if any man be a worshiper of God and do his will, him he hear. So this should motivate us to want to do the will of God. Brother, grab one more precept in Acts 26, verses 15 through 18.
Okay. What was the chapter one more time?
26, verses 15 through 18.
God, this is the book of Acts, chapter 26, starting at verse 15. And I said, Who art thou, Lord? And he said, I am Yahawashi, whom thou persecutest. But rise and stand up upon thy feet, for I have appeared unto thee for this purpose, to make thee a minister and a witness both of these things which thou hast seen, and of those things in the which I will appear unto thee, delivering thee from the people and from the Gentiles, unto whom now I send thee, to open their eyes and to turn them from darkness to light, and from the power of Satan unto God, that they may receive forgiveness of sins and inheritance among them which are sanctified by faith that is in me.
And I'm just going to highlight verse 18. It says, so this is talking about why Yahawashi was sent. It says to open their eyes and to turn them from darkness to light. Hold on. I thought he just came, just he died and we just believe in him and now we saved. No, it said he came to open our eyes and to turn us from darkness to light. So this shows that the disobedient acts we were committing, we stop and we obey. And from the power of Satan unto God, that they may receive forgiveness of sins and inheritance among them which are sanctified by faith that is in me. Something that's very important, it says, you know, after we turn from darkness to light and from the power of Satan unto God, this is, it says, that they may receive forgiveness of sins. So you're only going to receive forgiveness for your sins when you stop doing that stuff. You can't just keep running to the church house every Sunday and think that the Most High God going to forgive you. That's not the way it works. We have to stop. It says, them which are sanctified by faith, inheritance among them which are sanctified by faith that is in me. So our faith is what cleanses us. Our faith, our belief, our obedience to the Most High God is what sanctifies us. It's what cleans us up. But I'll read something from this Bible I have. This was a gift. It's called the Heritage Edition Bible. It was a gift from my aunt. It used to belong to my grandfather. He used to be a pastor. And this is this huge Bible. He got a lot of stuff in here. And it has this passage, and it's about faith. It says, faith is a marvelous thing, for it leads us in spirit to the foot of the cross, considering the sacrifice of his life that Yahawashi made for us. We confess our sins, we receive forgiveness, and our sins are no longer held against us. Just as a father may deposit in his son's bank account sufficient money to pay his debts and care for all his needs, so Yahawashi has provided forgiveness and power for each of us. But if that son did not believe that his father had provided funds for him and would not go to the bank to claim them, they would never do him any good. So it is with the Savior and us, we must believe his word and claim his promise of forgiveness for past sins and power for victory over temptation. Then they immediately become ours, and we thank him for them. So it's showing that if we can, you know, all day say we believe, but this forgiveness and, you know, this sacrifice that the Most High God sent his son to do, you know, to give us eternal life, is like money in the bank that we can't get if we're not obedient. So that money in the bank that he got for us, we have the power to actually access that money when we're obedient. It's like a trust fund. You know how they have a trust fund set up for a child when he gets out of college? They say, hey, you're not getting that trust fund. I mean, when he goes to college, you're not getting that trust fund. If you don't graduate high school, you don't get the money. So we have to get to the point where we're able to receive that reward that the Most High God has laid up for us. And, I'll end with that. If any other brothers got any more precepts, I know Brother Devon had more, so go ahead, brother.
Okay. And so I wanted to go to 2 Corinthians chapter 13 and verse 5.
Okay. And Brother Hurt, definitely a beautiful lesson as well.
Yeah, kind of.
The water, bro.
He dang that took everything away.
Hey, you said 2 Corinthians, what was the chapter?
13:5.
Okay. It's the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 13, starting at verse 5. Examine yourselves, whether ye be in the faith. Prove your own selves. Know ye not your own selves, how that Yahawashah the Anointed is in you, except ye be reprobates.
God. And so, just got to reiterate that, is we have to examine ourselves to see if we even in the faith. And the reason why is because it's such thing as reprobate behavior. You know, some people, they have reprobate behavior. They do certain things while saying they believe. You know, it's like the whole saying why people don't want to go to church. They say, hey, I see the same women up on in church singing, saying hallelujah on Sunday that was in the club on Saturday night. We gotta make sure we don't have reprobate behavior. We have to examine ourselves daily to make sure that we walk in the accord to the scriptures. But if you don't mind, could you go to Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 22 and 23?
Okay. I'm gonna make a point real quick while he grabbing that. Off of what you said, it brought a memory back to my head. So crazy, because I remember being in them streets, and then every once in a while, I guess out of guilt, you want to go to the church.
Oh, Easter.
No, it wouldn't even be Easter. It'd just be a random Sunday. It's just doing wickedness and go to church this Sunday. Then you go, and shoot, as soon as I used to leave the church, I'm smoking a cigarette in the parking lot. Just backwards, you know, but Christianity kind of grooms you to think that's okay, because everybody's flawed. We all sinners. And you just kind of mentally just accept that. Yeah.
God, what was that verse?
Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 22 and 23.
And I think the brother brought this out. Hebrews 10, verse 22. Let us draw near with the true heart and full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering, for he is faithful that promised.
Without what? Without wavering. That is the important part. It's because it seemed like that whenever people go through trials and tribulations, that's when they waver. You know, their job get too hard. They got, you know, relationship problems. They lose a family member. Next thing you know, they lose in faith.
All right.
It's like God's their enemy now. God took them too soon. No, God took them in the perfect timing. Mm-hmm. You know, let's go to James chapter 1 and verse 5 through 7.
It's the book of James chapter 1, starting at verse 5. If any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God, that giveth to all men liberally, and upbraideth not, and it shall be given him. But let him ask in faith, not wavering. For he that wavereth is like a wave of the sea driven with the wind and tossed. But let not that man think that he shall receive anything of the Lord.
Mm. So that's how important your faith is. Because without that, like people, they'll say, I pray to God that he's going to help me with this. And then the whole time they're trying to figure something out. The Most High, he's gonna lay it in front of you. It doesn't mean that you don't need to have any effort, but it's a difference when you stress about it. Because if you're stressing about it, that means you ain't put it in the Most High's hand. You don't really have faith on it. But you got anything, brother? I ain't trying to go into a whole nother lesson.
Now your brother spoke well through the Spirit. All praises. Just a quick point in Hebrews 4, and the brother Hurdy brought out a beautiful lesson on the topic of how important is your faith, right? And so I'm gonna go into the book of Hebrews chapter 4, and I'm gonna start at 1. It says, let us therefore fear lest a promise being left us of entering into his rest any of you should seem to come short of it. For unto us was the gospel preached, as well as unto them. But the word preached did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in them that heard it. Right? And the them that is referring to, you know, were our ancestors, you know, in the wilderness when we first came out of Egypt, right? And so this is speaking to the fact that our ancestors in the wilderness, they heard the gospel, right? And the gospel is chiefly the restoration to the world through Israel's restoration, right? You read that through a myriad of scriptures, but they heard the same message. You know, Abraham, he understood these things and he passed it down, to his children and to the chosen seed, and they understood these things. But as Hebrews 4:2 said, they heard these things, but it didn't profit them, right? Because they didn't have the proper faith, right? They didn't live out or perform acceptable faithfulness, right? You even read that in the book of I believe Deuteronomy, the 3rd chapter, Psalm, the 95th chapter, and you even read it in the previous chapter in Hebrews 3, right? But when you jump down, let me jump all the way down to verse 6. All right, it says, seeing therefore it remaineth that some must enter therein, and they to whom it was first preached enter not in because of unbelief, right? So we have to make sure, and this is why it's very important, to think on these things, like how important is your faith, because the previous generation, they didn't enter into the Most High's rest, which was the land and things like that, because of their faith, right? Because of their belief in the Most High, their trustworthiness, their steadfastness, their loyalty to the Most High. They didn't receive the promises of the Most High because of this particular topic, which is faith, right? So we have to make sure, that we're adding righteousness to virtue, virtue to faith, etc. Like, the book of 2 Peter, the 1st chapter says, right? So this was definitely a beautiful lesson. And I'm going to pass it back to the brother if he want to say anything before he ends out the lesson.
The water, brother. The water, brother Aaron, for the reading. The water for the precepts. And the water divine for the precepts. Everybody that's watching, if you haven't already, make sure you like, you share the video. The water for y'all that liked and shared already, and for the comments. Anybody that's watching on the replay, if you could, please do the same. We really appreciate it. And just want to end it with giving all praise, honor, and glory to the Most High God, whose name is Yahweh, by Shem Yahweh Shai. That's in the name of his only begotten son, whose name is Yahweh Shai. And brother, if you could, go ahead and close it out.
Khan, we'll close it out with number 6 and 24 on down. It says, Yahweh bless thee and keep thee. Yahweh make his face shine upon thee and be gracious unto thee. Yahweh lift up his countenance upon thee and give thee peace. And they shall put my name upon the children of Israel, and I will bless them. And with that, I'll say shalom.
And my bad, y'all. One more thing. Tomorrow, my album or EP is dropping, my first Truth Music EP entitled Salvation. Make sure y'all get it. And with that, I say shalom. All praise to the Most High.
You are not just an Edomite in this life, you're an Edomite in the next life. Forever be an Edomite. This is what the Bible says. You will never be an Israelite. I will never be an Israelite. You will never be an Israelite.
When this kingdom comes and this will be done, I know vengeance is the Lord's, they gon' pay for what they done. When this kingdom come and this will be done, I know vengeance is the Lord's, they gon' pay for what they done. That's don't nobody wanna face the truth about how we really got here. Want us to forget about slavery like it never happened, but them slave ships important, a key connection to our past. Read Deuteronomy 28 to help you feel what I'm saying. We were forced on this land, allowed by Yahweh's hand, but it was all for a purpose, part of a bigger plan. They still talk about the Holocaust, ignore our mass genocide. We ain't been propagated again, this country built on lies. Yeah, I know y'all ain't the ones who put us in chains, but them y'all ancestors, that blood still run through your veins. Bless your status in society, it's cause you reap them benefits from the carnage that was sold. Please don't try to act ignorant like your forefathers was innocent, and the issues don't concern you. They've been reincarnated, your ancestors are you. Look at the way that you treat us, shoot us down in the streets, throw us in cages like animals. This ain't the land of the free. When this kingdom come and this will be done, I know vengeance is the Lord's, they gon' pay for what they done. When this kingdom come and this will be done, I know vengeance is the Lord's, they gon' pay for what they done. When this kingdom come and this will be done, I know vengeance is the Lord's, they gon' pay for what they done. When this kingdom come and this will be done, I know vengeance is the Lord's, they gon' pay. have I loved. But Esau have I hated. You touch the apple of his eye. It's something you won't get away with. They understand what they face. I see it in their eyes. When they look at my friends, they know Israel rising. Dry bones being awakened. The kingdom's eyes for the taking. We renewing our minds. Taking all lies from Satan. Eat them the vessels of wrath. And they've been fitted for destruction. I'll never be cool with my oppressor. The Bible tell me not to trust them. Still God is knowledge. But fools despise instruction. They need a Bible college for wisdom. The Holy Spirit. Spirit instructs me. Sucklers need milk, they can't digest. They can't meet, just unlearn. So they misinterpret John 3:16. Christ died for all, but everybody don't need saving. Deliverance is the essence of our eternal salvation. Inheritance is Israel, God deals with no other nation. His words can't come back void, your emotions won't make it. When his kingdom come, and his will be done, I know vengeance is the Lord's, they gon' pay for what they done. When his kingdom come, and his will be done, I know vengeance is the Lord's, they gon' pay for what they done. When his kingdom come,